Let us discuss about Graves' disease. Graves' disease is the most common cause of hyperthyroidism. Okay. Graves' disease. Graves' disease is the most common cause of hyperthyroidism. So in Graves' disease, what we see is hyperthyroidism. Okay, in Graves' disease, what happens is we have thyroid stimulating hormone receptors on thyroid tissue, right? In thyroid gland, we have receptors for thyroid stimulating hormone, right? Here in this disorder, what happens is autoantibodies will be formed against this thyroid stimulating hormone receptors. Okay, antibodies are formed against thyroid stimulating hormone receptors. These antibodies are stimulating antibodies, that means they stimulate the receptors. These are stimulating autoantibodies that are formed against thyroid stimulating hormone receptors. Okay, so as this receptors are stimulated by the autoantibodies, it results in increased release of thyroid hormones that results in hyperthyroidism. Okay, so in Graves' disease, what happens is there is formation of thyroid stimulating acute antibody against TSS receptors. Okay, Graves' disease is associated with HLA-B8 and DR3. And this Graves' disease has got some symptoms, right? Every disease will have symptoms. Let's see the characteristic features of Graves' disease. First one is there will be thyrotoxicosis, because there is increased release of thyroid hormones, which results in thyrotoxicosis. And there will be ophthalmopathy, exophthalmos. Okay, in ophthalmopathy, what we see is exophthalmosis. This exophthalmosis is due to collection of loose areolar tissue behind the eyeball. Due to exophthalmosis means there will be protrusion of eyeballs, right? So this exophthalmos is due to collection of loose areolar tissue behind the eyeball. So there is accumulation of loose areolar tissue behind the eyeball, which results in exophthalmosis. Then one more is dermatopathy. It is also called pre-tibial myxedema. Dermatopathy is also called as pre-tibial myxedema. This is due to deposition of glycosaminoglycans. Okay, due to deposition of deposition of glycosaminoglycans. Glycosaminoglycans, and is also found in hypothyroidism. This dermatopathy can also be seen in hypothyroidism also. That means this is not specific to Graves' disease. This is also seen in hypothyroidism as well. Other features include gynecomastia. Gynecomastia. These are the characteristic features. Then we'll move to clinical features. That means signs and symptoms. Clinical features. That is signs and symptoms. So the first is signs and symptoms due to sympathetic stimulation. Due to sympathetic stimulation, there is sympathetic stimulation in Graves' disease, and the symptoms will also be due to sympathetic stimulation. Let us see the symptoms. One is tachycardia. Second is palpitation. Third is excessive sweating. Fourth one is tremors. These tremors are fine tremors in fingers and tongue. Okay. And next, the signs and symptoms due to thyroid stimulation. So due to thyroid stimulation, there will be increased BMR. This increased BMR is due to increased uptake and sorry there will be decreased BMR there will be decreased appetite sorry there will be decreased BMR this decreased BMR is due to increased uptake, but even then there will be weight loss. Okay, increased appetite will be there, but there will be weight loss. In spite of increased appetite, there will be weight loss. And excess sweating, heat intolerance, diarrhea. This is the most common symptom of hyperthyroidism. Diarrhea is the most common symptom of GIT in hyperthyroidism. In females, we'll see amenorrhea and increased risk of abortion and infertility also. In females, what we see is amenorrhea. We'll also see risk of abortion, and we'll also see infertility. In children, early growth retardation and sorry in a children we'll see early growth and maturation in children we'll see early growth early growth and maturation. In young patient, CNS symptoms will be predominant. Whereas in elderly, severe symptoms will be more. This is about signs and symptoms. Let us see the findings in thyroid gland in Graves' disease. Graves' disease. One is hyperactive, that means increased uptake of thyroid radioactive iodine. First is increased uptake of radioactive iodine, and there will be increased vascularity in thyroid gland. That means hypervascularity. Increased hypervascularity. This is most predominant at upper pole. Hypervascularity is most predominant at upper pole. There will be palpable thrill, and there will be audible bruit. Okay, fifth one is, now there will be audible venous hum. Okay, all these things are seen. Then investigation for diagnosis. There is presence of eye signs. So investigation, what we do is we look for eye signs. These eye signs are diagnostic in patients of hyperthyroidism. As all of us know, hyperthyroidism is seen in Graves' disease. And the single investigation used to confirm the diagnosis is presence of antibodies. We look for antibodies. Antibodies are formed against TSH receptors, right? So we look for the antibodies. Then moving to management. We'll give treatment for sympathetic stimulation. So we won't reduce the sympathetic stimulation. So we'll go propranolol. Propranolol. We'll also give anti-thyroid drugs. Anti-thyroid drugs. The drugs we give here are methimazole. Methimazole, carbimazole, propylthiouracil, thiouracil. And the side effects of methimazole is okay. And if we give before going to side effects, we'll see. If you give antithyroid drugs within 2 weeks, there will be symptomatic improvement. Within 2 weeks, there will be symptomatic improvement. And in within 6 weeks, there will be euthyroid, and the patient will become euthyroid. Within 6 weeks. The patient becomes euthyroid. Now let's see the side effects of these drugs. So the first is methimazole. The side effects of methimazole is choanal atresia, aplasia cutis. Agranulocytosis. Then coming to side effects of propylthiouracil. In propylthiouracil, the side effects are hepatic failure. The side effects is mainly hepatic failure, and especially this happens in children and females. Then we'll see the drug of choice for different conditions in different situations. For Graves' disease, it's mainly methimazole. In Graves' disease, we mainly use methimazole, right? There are many, as I told you, there are mainly three drugs, right? Methimazole, carbimazole, and propylthiouracil. We mainly use methimazole. Okay. But in pregnancy, when the patient is pregnant, then we'll use carbimazole. In a thyrotoxic crisis, we'll use propylthiouracil, because this propylthiouracil, it prevents conversion of T4 to T3. This conversion will be impaired, will be affected. So propylthiouracil is used for thyrotoxic crisis. You see, T3 is the main enzyme that does action, okay. Peripherally T4 will be converted to T3 for the action to be done. For action to happen, T4 must be converted to T3. So T3 will do action. So this conversion will be affected by propylthiouracil. So we use propylthiouracil in thyrotoxicosis. And treatment of choice is surgical treatment, mainly total thyroidectomy. This is surgical treatment, okay? Total thyroidectomy. Alternative treatment is radioactive iodine ablation. Other treatment is radioactive iodine ablation. Let us see the indications of this radioactive iodine ablation. We are discussing about radioactive iodine ablation. Let us see the indications. Indications are elderly patients. Because you see, in radioactive iodine ablation, what happens is the we'll try to make the patient hypothyroid. Radioactive iodine ablation, thyroid tissue will be destroyed. Will destroy the thyroid tissue permanently. So the if more tissue is damaged or destroyed, then the person will become hypothyroidism permanently. So in young patient, we do not prefer this. We usually don't prefer, because if the patient becomes hypothyroidism permanently, then it will be problematic to that patient. Okay, so we'll prefer this type of treatment in elderly patients. Second one is patients with surgical comorbidities. That means if there are any contraindications to the surgery, then we prefer this radioactive iodine ablation. And if there is reoccurrence after surgery, in these three conditions we prefer radioactive iodine ablation. One is elderly patients, second one is patients with surgical comorbidities, and third is recurrence after surgery. Let us see contraindications, absolute contraindications and relative contraindications. Absolute contraindications are pregnancy and lactation. Relative contraindications are young patients and smokers and in ophthalmopathy. Okay, in ophthalmopathy, these are the relative contraindications. Okay, so this is about radioactive ablation and the treatment and management of Graves' disease.